together. The church is better together. Across boundaries and borders, beyond walls and notions, we're part of something far more powerful, far more potent than any of us could ever fully imagine or dream. A mission far bigger than any of us could ever accomplish on our own. We exist to make Jesus known. And in that pursuit, we become the best version of who God created us to be. A reflection of His love, His truth, His grace, His hands, His feet. One in mission, one in heart, one in love for Jesus and people. Arms locked to serve, give, and show the world His love, which has no equal. And when we do, God goes before us. Hope rises. People turn their feet to Jesus. Families grow stronger. Communities come together. Lives forever change for the better. Victory is won. This is church. This is together. This is who we are. It's what we were made for. And all the glory goes to the one who makes it all possible. Jesus. To His name be all the glory, honor, and praise. Welcome to the movement, 2,000 years in the making. Welcome to church.
Well, hey, church, where you are, good morning. Welcome to Asheville, North Carolina. You know, we got a lot of extra calories to burn, so we decided to go on a little early morning hike before church here. That's where we're checking in from this weekend. I'm Brian, one of the pastors around here. So glad that you found us today. Hey, we've got hosts live in the chat right now that are ready and willing to answer any questions you might have today to get you connected to what we're doing here at Church Where You Are. People joining virtually all across, sure, North Carolina, Texas, California, Wisconsin, 16 plus states checking in today, joining virtually, but it's bigger than a virtual experience, guys. It's who you're with. Church is people. So we pray that you have had a wonderful weekend so far with your family and friends, and just being together is a big deal. So check in with us in the chat. Let us know who you're with today and what your Thanksgiving brought. We're so grateful that we just get a chance to see you guys every Sunday, and we want to get you connected beyond today. So download our Church Where You Are app and make church bigger than just a virtual experience. We'll help you with that. We'll be in the Bible app this week again, reading the Bible together in the YouVersion Bible app. So join us, and now it's time to worship.
I raise a hallelujah. My weapon is a melody. I raise a hallelujah. Heaven comes to fight for me. I'm gonna sing in the middle of the storm. Louder and louder, you're gonna hear my praises roar. King is alive. I raise a hallelujah with everything inside of me. Oh, I raise a hallelujah. Fear, you lost your hold. Sing gonna hear my praises roar up from the ashes. Hope will arise, yes. Death is defeated. The King is alive, yes. I love you, Lord. Oh, your mercy never fails me. All my days I've been held in your hands. From the moment that I wake up until I lay my head, I will sing of the goodness of God. Of God, I love your voice. You have led me through the fire. In darkest nights, you are close like no other. I've known you as a father, I've known you as a friend, and I have lived in the goodness of God. Oh yes. In all my life you have been faithful. Oh, all my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, I will sing of the goodness of God. Oh yes. And your goodness is running after, it's running after me. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. With my life laid down, I surrender now, I give it. It's running after, it's running after me. And all my life you have been faithful. All my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, I will sing of the goodness of God. I will sing of the goodness of God.
Well, amen. Hey, the hugest praise to the one who makes it all possible. Are you with me? Amen on that? Hey, lots going on this last week. I know you've been asked already what you're thankful for. I'm going to ask you again. Tell us in the chat, what are you thankful for? And whatever you do in word or in deed, do everything in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God the Father through him. Colossians 3:17. I just love that verse so much. Do everything. Everything. Not some things, but everything. Seeking to honor him in word and deed. So it's in those moments, guys, that we have those opportunities, that we see our priorities and the orientation of our heart. So we're going to continue in that element. In a time of worship, this is giving, this is Jesus asking of the best of our time, talent, and treasure. Remember, it's not the size of the gift, but it's the position of a cheerful, giving heart that the Lord desires. So thank you for saying yes to trusting God with your tithes and gifts, your generosity. It allows us to continue connecting people here at church where you are to advance this mission. You can give in two ways. You can use our app. It's called Church Where You Are. It's available for free in our app store. Again, it's called church where you are, just hit that give tab in the bottom right-hand corner of the menu and you're good to go. If you prefer to text to give, you can still pull out that mobile device, text any dollar amount using your mobile device to 84321. Pretty straightforward. Little setup if it's your first time. Just choose church where you are as your preferred church and text any dollar amount to 84321. Remember, guys, it's just reminding ourselves that He is our provider, that He's worthy. We want to go before Him and honor Him in word and deed. And we're going to honor Him just right now, just with conversation. You know, He desires to talk to us. So we're going to go before Him right now. Lord, we just come before You today with open hands, Lord. And we want You to open our heart. Lord, sometimes we close our fists. We start to look at our life and we say all the things that we don't have. And that closes our heart off. Lord, You have set the record straight. Above all else, You have given us the gift of eternal life, of salvation. Lord, we are so grateful, Heavenly Father, that You sent Jesus to rescue us, Lord, when we didn't even ask for it. Lord, we're so thankful for the sacrifice that Jesus, Your Son, made on the cross to allow us to have a restored relationship with You. We're thankful and we're grateful. And Lord, we want to move forward this week honoring You in word and deed, in everything, Lord, in the way that we show up in spaces, our presence with people, in the way that we give of our time and our talents that You have bestowed us with, Lord, and also in our treasure, that which we often hold so close to our heart and guard. We want to give away open-handed living, Lord, because we know that You are faithful to use those gifts to advance Your kingdom and to remind us of the true nature of the giver, the heart of a servant. Thank You for sending Jesus to show us that. In Your name, amen.
So excited that you are joining us today. For those that don't know me, my name is Jason Tucker. I'm one of the pastors here, and I'm excited that you're here today. Do me a favor right now, wherever you're watching from, in the chat, the comment section there, just let us know where you're watching from today. Maybe say hi to somebody in the chat. We've got people here gathered from California to the Carolinas, from Texas, all the way up to Wisconsin, and we love it when you find ways to connect with that group of people in community. So say hey to somebody that's watching today or you're hanging out with, doing church with today. It means the world to us when you connect like that. So we're continuing on in a series. It's actually the final week of a series called The Family Table. And basically what we've been talking about leading up to and through Thanksgiving has really been this idea of what is being served at the table of your life and my life in this holiday season ahead. We've been talking about things that, according to Scripture, in particular, this one passage in Romans chapter 12, that we're encouraged as followers of Christ to make sure that are being served at our tables. We've talked about forgiveness. We've talked about hospitality. We've talked about peacemaking being served at our tables. And today we're going to take it one step further. Hopefully you had a great Thanksgiving and a lot of love was being served at your table. A lot of love was being served at your table. That's what we're talking about today, is making sure that love is served at our tables. So today, I don't know, you know, again, I don't know if this makes you sad or happy, but we just came off of this beautiful holiday called Thanksgiving, where we get around the table and we share some of this love right here. Check this out. You know what I'm talking about? Like, maybe you see that now and that looks like a lot of regret. I know for me, I get it. I might have eaten a little too much, but no, what's beautiful about Thanksgiving is that those Thanksgiving meals are a great sign of love spread across the table, made with loving hands and made by people who love us and we love them. And we, again, put our hands to serve and love those around the table as we cook those meals. And so that's really a great reminder in this season, obviously Thanksgiving, but even leading up to Christmas, that love should be served at our tables. And that's what this passage in Romans 12, which we've been talking about, it says a lot about. Let me just read it to you today. We're really going to focus on two sentences in this passage. Romans 12, verse 9 and 10, it says this. It says, "Love must be sincere. Hate what is evil, cling to what is good, be devoted to one another." You guessed it. In love. Be devoted to one another in love. Honor one another above yourselves. Now, obviously, that's the NIV translation of the Bible. And what I'm about to read you is basically a paraphrase of that very passage. It's not a translation of scripture, but it's a paraphrase. And I want to read it to you for the sake of our discussion today, because I think it's really, really good. This is found in the Message paraphrase of the Bible. Same scripture. This is basically someone's perspective on what we just read. Listen to this. "Love from the center of who you are. Don't fake it. Run for dear life from evil. Hold on for dear life to good. Be good friends who love deeply. Practice playing second fiddle." You know, in those two sentences, if we just allow ourselves to go there today, we get a great picture of what sincere and genuine love looks like. And we start to learn what it looks like in our lives when we're serving a sincere and genuine love at the table of our lives, in our relationships, with our family, our friends, our coworkers, even with opposing fan bases. Come on, Michigan, Ohio State fans, come on. come on, don't tune out. Too soon, maybe a little too soon. I don't know. Come on, I took one on the chin. Again, I'm a graduate of the Ohio State University, so I took a third shot to the chin, so I'm with you there. But, you know, yes, even sincere love between competing fan bases. Yes, even sincere love there. So today, what I want to look at, and I believe what we're looking at during this series is sincere love being served at my table? At the table of my life, when it comes down to when people are around me this holiday season, when they get to spend time with me or I get to spend time with them, is sincere love something that I can rest assured that is being served at the table of my life? And the question that I think we have to answer in order to discuss that is this: what does that kind of love look like? What does that kind of love look like? Now, I'll tell you for today, if you are looking for a good read on what sincere love is, there's a great book out there. It's called Love Does. And it's a book written by a guy named Bob Goff. It's several years old. It's not a new book, but I will tell you that the truths in this book are eye-opening when it comes down to what sincere love looks like. I'd go as far as to say this is a masterclass on what it means to sincerely and genuinely love people. So some of the message today, I would say you're probably going to get a paraphrase of a great deal of things that are discussed in that book and in scripture in great detail. So pick it up if you're looking for a good read. But here's the first thing. If I want to know if sincere love is being served at my table, then I need to ask myself this question, or essentially come to grips with this truth. Sincere love is genuine at heart. Sincere love is genuine at heart. Romans 12, chapter 12, verse 9. Remember the paraphrase. It said this: love from the center of who you are. Don't fake it. Don't fake it. Don't fake love. You know, that word, fake it, there's a popular word in our culture today that we use when people are faking it. We call them hypocrites. Hypocrites, right? That's being hypocritical when you fake something. When you say one thing, but you actually do another, that's a word that we use in our society today. But actually, that word, hypocrite, was used to describe people in Greece. It was a Greek word used to describe people who were actors, people who wore masks and acted out a part. Check this picture out. Super, super creepy. I know. Super creepy. But that is a picture of hypocrites. Hypocrites is what they used to call them. And these were people who would put on masks and play a part. They were basically actors. It wasn't genuine. They were pretending to be something that they were not. And essentially, what Paul is reminding us of in Romans 12 is, he's saying, be sincere. Love one another sincerely. Make your love sincere. And if your love is sincere, you can't wear masks, right? Sincere love is not wearing masks. It's recognizing the difference between real love and fake love. When I'm really loving someone, and when I'm faking it that I love someone. Now, I understand sometimes that's a blurry line, right? Sometimes that's a blurry line. But the truth of the matter is, it really is pretty simple when we boil it down. I love how Bob Goff says it. This is a quote from his book, Love Does. He says, none of us wants to make God look bad, but in the end, being fake makes God look bad. I want you to think about that. You know, sometimes the difference between fake love and real love is a blurry line. But as a follower of Christ, we should really ask ourselves the question, is my love for the people around my table, my family, my friends, my coworkers, my neighbors, is my love for them genuine at heart? Because I don't want to fake it. I don't want to make God look bad. I want to make sure that it is sincere in heart. These were Jesus's words, okay? And this is important. John chapter 13, Jesus said, a new command I give you. Love one another as I have loved you. So you must love one another. By this, everyone will know that you are my disciples if you love one another. What's Jesus saying here? He's saying this. If you want to know what genuine love looks like, genuine love looks like me. Watch me, keep your eye on me, see how I handle my relationships with people, watch how I act towards people, watch essentially how I treat other people. And if you watch how Jesus treats people or acts towards people, if you and I model that, that is how we can rest assured that our love is genuine love, that we're not faking it. If we are acting in a way or treating people in a way that Jesus treats them, then we can rest assured that that's what real love looks like. In essence, Jesus is saying, if you want to know what genuine love looks like, genuine love looks like me. Jesus is saying, genuine love looks like me. Look at me. Watch me. See what I do. See how I handle my relationships. And that's how you will know that you are a follower of Jesus and that your love is genuine. 1 John 3 says this, dear children, let's not merely say that we love each other. Let's show. Let's not merely say, let's show. Let's show people. Jesus didn't just say he loved people. He showed his love for people. It says, let's show that, again, let's show it, let's show the truth by our actions. Our actions will show that we belong to the truth, so we will be confident when we stand before God. We're genuine in our love for people when we show our love for people through our actions. When we take actionable steps to love them genuinely, forgive them genuinely. You get my drift? It's not just something that we say. It's not just I say I love you. It's I show that I love you. And when I do that, when I keep my eyes on how Jesus loves people and I show them that love, that's how I know my love is genuine at heart. Second thing, sincere love has good motives. Sincere love has good motives. We're asking ourselves the question, what does sincere love look like? What does genuine love look like? Well, we said genuine love, sincere love, it's genuine at heart. But then the second thing, it's also, it has good motives towards other people, right? What did 12:9 say again? Romans 12:9, it said, run for dear life from evil, hold on for dear life to good. Run for dear life from evil. If your motives are bad, you're not running from dear life from evil. Cling for dear life to good. In other words, hold on for dear life to good motives towards other people. You know, our motives are our reason for doing things. We do things based on our motives. Now, if we're honest with ourselves today, there is a deeply rooted question here that we all have to answer for ourselves if we want to make sure that the love that's being served at our table is genuine. And that question essentially rotates around this idea. There's a big difference between my motives and God's motives. Come on, somebody. There's a big difference between my motives and God's motives. What's the difference? Well, my motives oftentimes are me-focused. My motives are me-focused. They're focused on me, on essentially what's good for me in the situation. That is how my motives are by default geared or pointed. But God motives are different motives. God's motives are focused on others above their own, above God focusing on himself, right? That's essentially what we see in Jesus, that God so loved the world that he gave Jesus. That I say it this way, when we cared absolutely nothing about Jesus or about God, come on somebody, God cared absolutely everything about us. What were his motives? His motives were that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. He wanted good for us even when we didn't want good for him. So when you keep that in mind and you think about these motives, it's important to know the difference between my motives and God's motives. That's why we're encouraged to love what God loves and hate what God hates, right? Love what God loves, hate what God hates. Again, run from evil for dear life. Cling to what is good for dear life. What does that mean? It means to love what God loves and to hate what God hates. Now, if you boil it down, I can answer those two questions in two words. What does God love? You ready? People. God loves people. What does God hate? Sin. God hates sin. God loves people, but he hates sin. And so in that, there lies the tension, right? The tension is, if we're going to have good motives, we have to do the same. We have to love what God loves and hate what God hates. We have to love people and hate sin. That's really, really important that we see people are not their sin. Even though people do things to us that are hurtful, or we do things to other people that are hurtful, according to Jesus, you're a new creation in Christ. That in Christ, I'm a new creation and my old life is gone. And so evaluating people or seeing people as something that God loves and seeing people as something that is very dear to God and not judging people or having motives toward people based on their sin, boy, that's a big ask. But at the same time, if we want to make sure that our love is sincere, it's something that we need to embrace. 2 Corinthians 5 says this. It says, so from now on, we no longer regard we regard no one from a worldly point of view. In other words, we don't just see people for their sin and their mistakes and their messiness. No, though we once regarded Christ this way, we do so no longer. So I want you to think about that. What does that look like on you and on me if we're going to serve sincere love at our table? It looks like this. When we look around at our tables this holiday season, in the coming weeks at Christmas and with our family, our friends, our coworkers, even opposing fan bases, when we look around, the question is this: do we see sin or do we see people? Do we see people's sin or do we actually see people? Do we see the problems or do we see the person? Do we see the obstacles like unforgiveness and the past and words that have been said and things that have been done that are creating distance between us? Or do we see opportunities to show people love, the love that Christ showed us? Or do we see a comparing with other people, or do we have compassion on people? It's a great question to ask when it comes to our motives. What we see should tell us a lot about what our motives are. If I see only things that are good for me, the chances are I'm choosing my motives. But if I want to have good motives, sincere and genuine motives, I need to make sure I'm taking the angle to embrace God's motives, a love for people and a hate for sin. That's why David prayed this prayer in Psalm 139, just to keep his heart right. Come on, it's a great prayer. All of us could be praying. He said this. He said, "Search me, O God, and know my heart. Test me and know my anxious thoughts. Point out anything." Come on, in the chat right now. What does it say? Point out anything. Next two words on the count of three. One, two, three. Point out anything, God, in me. Point out anything in me that offends you and lead me along the path of everlasting life. Point out anything in me. I want to start with me. If I want my motives to be pure, I'm going to start right here. I don't want to just be all about what Jason wants out of this. I want to be about what God wants out of this. Every relationship, every conversation, I want to have good motives. I want to be genuine at heart. I want to have good motives. And so I'm always going to begin by saying, hey, God, start with me. Point out anything in me that offends you. I don't want to do anything that offends you, and lead me on the path of everlasting life. Next thing, if I want to make sure that genuine love, sincere love is being served at my table, sincere love is loyal and devoted. It's loyal and devoted. Romans 12:10 says, be good friends. This is the paraphrase. Be good friends who love people deeply. Be good friends who love people deeply. What does a good friend that loves people deeply look like? What does that look like? It's somebody that keeps showing up in our lives, even when it's messy. Come on, somebody. hopefully you've had some good friends that have loved you deeply in times in your life when you've been messy or you found yourself in a messy situation and they showed up in your life. That's what good friends do. Good friends love us when there's nothing in it for them. They love deeply when there's nothing in it for them, when it costs them something, when it's hard, when they have to get their hands dirty in our lives. You know, one of the best examples that I personally have ever seen of this is it was my father. He passed away several years ago, but one of the things that I remember very vividly is being a kid and going on running appliance repair service calls with him. My family had an appliance repair business, jacuzzi repair installation. We did several things like that. But as a little kid, my dad used to take me on service calls with him to go to people's houses. And we'd walk down into their basement. I'd be carrying the heavy toolbox down into their basement. And I just always remember the conversations that he would have with people. I wouldn't know these people from anybody, but he would strike up a conversation with them like he's known them for years because he had. He had been to their house many different times, and in many cases, he'd fixed many of their appliances. Washers, dryers, dishwashers, disposals, water heaters, all of these different things Home Appliances, he had a relationship built. So he'd walk in and he'd be on a first name basis, and he'd ask them questions about their families and different things, all the while laying on their basement floor and being up underneath the washer, like working on their washer. And I remember as a kid thinking, like, Dad, we gotta go. We got more calls to get to. Like, we're trying to make some money here. we gotta get more calls done. Sometimes we'd stay and talk in their basements for sometimes hours at a time. He'd even pray with them or ask them how he could pray for them. And I remember one day going to the truck and asking my dad, getting in the passenger seat, and his hands, I remember seeing them as he got in the car, and his hands were very dirty. They looked like this. And I remember asking him, you know, like, hey, Dad, like, I mean, I feel like we could have gotten that done a lot quicker and moved on a lot faster. And my dad was also a pastor. He kind of did that in addition to working full-time as an appliance repairman. And that day he told me, he said, Jason, I want you to hear me say something that's very important. And this is a great lesson for your life. He said, I've had the opportunity to talk to more people about Jesus laying on their basement floor under their dirty washer than I've ever had the opportunity to talk to them behind a pulpit on a Sunday morning. I've had the opportunity to talk to more people laying on their basement floor with dirty hands under their washer than I've ever had the opportunity to talk to about Jesus behind a pulpit on Sunday morning. I want you to think about that, because that I really do believe that dirty hands are a great sign of loyal and devoted love. If we're not willing to get our hands dirty when it comes down to our relationships with people, if we're not willing to be devoted in the messiness, to show up when it's hard and keep showing up even when it's hard, I think we have to ask ourselves the question, do we sincerely love these people? I didn't say it's easy truth. It's definitely hard truth. But those words stuck with me, and I hope they stick with you the same way today. That's why I believe Proverbs 3:3-4 says this: let love and faithfulness never leave you. Bind them around your neck. Write them on the tablet of your heart. Then you will win favor and a good name in the sight of God and people. Love and faithfulness. Faithful love. Deep love. Sincere love. The kind of love that's ever pursuing people. That's always inviting. That's never giving up on people. 1 Peter 4:8 says, above all things, love each other deeply. Why? Why is it important to have deep love for people? Because love covers over a multitude of sin. Yes, there's going to be messiness. Yes, there's going to be relationships and hurt, or maybe words that have been said or things that have been done that are going to make loving people very difficult. But if our love is loyal and devoted, if it's genuine at heart, if it has good motives, come on, that's the kind of love we as followers of Jesus want to be serving at the table of our lives. Last thing I want to leave you with today, with the time we have left, sincere love. What does it look like? Sincere love is genuine at heart. It has good motives. It's loyal and devoted. But the last thing, it serves before being served. Sincere love serves others before being served. That's what Romans 12:10, that paraphrase, what did it say? It said, practice playing second fiddle. Practice playing second fiddle. Put some practice in not being the main attraction. Again, in the actual translation, it said, honor one another above yourselves. Honor one another above yourselves. That means serve other people. Serve other people before you ever seek to be served yourself. You know, to do this by default, it's just not easy, right? Come on, it's just not easy to have that kind of mentality that we would be all about seeing the best for others before we would seek the best for ourselves. But isn't that what Jesus did for us? Isn't that really, truly what love is? That, again, to love somebody when they love you, Jesus said, what credit is it to you to love the people that love you? Come on, that's easy. But he actually said, love those who are your enemies. Serve them. Pray for those who persecute you. Come on, I know that's a big challenge, but I know this, that is what sincere love looks like. And that's the kind of love that leads people to know the real and true Jesus, because that's what he did for us. Watch this. 1 John 4. This is love. This is love. Not that we loved God. Not that we did anything. Not that we loved God, but that he loved us. And he sent his son as an atoning sacrifice for our sins. What did I say earlier? God loves people. God hates sin. So what did he do? He loved us so much that he sent his son to serve our needs, to serve us. Think about that. We were broken and lost in our sin, but he sent his son to serve us, to sacrifice for our sin. And that passage finishes off. It says, "Dear friends, since God so loved us, we ought to love one another." I want you to think about that today, deeply, deeply. In the days ahead, what does sincere love look like? It looks like me serving others before they serve me. I go first in my service to them, just like Jesus did. They don't have to earn it or deserve it. I do it because this is love, because God loved me first. And because he loved me first, I can also love other people first as well. I love this quote from Love Does. Bob Goff, the writer, says this: "The rules of love are simple. Everybody, always." That's one of those things about divine love. It always assumes it can find a way to express itself. Come on, when we're loving like Jesus loves, our love expresses itself to other people, even when they don't earn it or deserve it. Why? Because God's love was expressed to me. It was expressed to you, even when we didn't earn it or deserve it. Come on, today I want to leave you with this question, because I know this is a lot to take in, and my hope today is when you hear this message that your heart is moved, first off, by God's love for you, but then also, in addition, that it's moved to love other people genuinely and sincerely just the same. What does sincere love look like? It's genuine at heart. It has good motives. It loves deeply, and it's loyal. And it serves other people before seeking to be served. So the question I think we should ask ourselves today and in the days ahead is this: is sincere love being served at my table? Is sincere love being served at my table? I want you to think of a person as we wrap up today that over these next several weeks that you can be intentional over this season ahead, through Christmas and even into the new year, that you can love like that, that you can sincerely and genuinely make sure that that kind of love is being poured out or served at your table. You know, if you're looking for a hint on where to start, let me just say this. Start with your family. Wives, start with your husbands. Husbands, start with your wives. Parents, start with your kids. Kids, start with your parents. Like, I dare you, kids, to go do dishes today for dad and mom, and watch. You may have to do CPR on the kitchen floor to your parents. That, again, go show them love and genuine love in action. For all of us, come on, with our family and our friends and our neighbors, go be more genuine in your love for each other. Start with those closest to you and then work your way out from there. Start checking your motives towards each other. Start making sure that you have God motives and not personal motives. Start getting your hands dirty in loyalty and devotion to each other, and serve each other, not just because there's something in it for you. No, no. Serve each other, not because of what you'll get, but because of what you've already gotten in Jesus Christ. I'm going to say that again, and then we're going to wrap this up. Serve other people, not because you want to get something from them, but serve them because of what you've already already gotten in Jesus Christ. Come on, today as we wrap this up, I just want to pray that God would help us in the days ahead to focus in on whoever it is that He wants us to share that genuine, sincere love with, and that we would take this call, this encouragement, if you will, to heart over this holiday season so that people can see and meet the real Jesus in their dealings with us as they see Him at work in our lives. Will you pray with me today? Well, God, this is challenging in many, many ways. First off, it's challenging just for us to step back from this season and just say thank you. Thank you for all the ways that you've blessed our lives. You know, we celebrate this this past Thursday. We celebrated Thanksgiving, and it really is a day to reflect on your goodness and your mercy and your love for us, and on all the good things that we're blessed with in this life. And so today we say thank you. Thank you for all the blessings. Thank you for all of the good things that you've given us, the love that you've given us, and our family, our friends, God, our neighbors, coworkers, loved ones. Thank you so much for love. And today we choose to go after sincere love, not because of anything we've done, but because of what you have done for us. You loved us and you laid your life down for us. You served us. Your motives were good towards us. You've been loyal and devoted to us. And you've been sincere in your love for us from the beginning. So God, today we choose to do the same. We can't do this without you. So I'm asking you, Holy Spirit, to help us, guide us, keep our eyes fixed on Jesus in the days ahead as we seek to serve sincere and genuine love at the table of our lives. We love you. We give you honor and praise today, and we thank you for loving us. Come on, today, if you're here and maybe up till today, you've cared very little about God or even the idea that He loved you enough to send His Son Jesus, but today, for whatever reason, your heart has become open to the truth that God loves you, that He wants good things for your life today. And for whatever reason, you're ready to get your heart right with God today. If that's you, I want you to know it's not a prayer that saves you. It's the posture of your heart in this moment where if you know that's you and that's what you want, I'll lead you in a conversation right now that you can have with God right where you are. You don't have to say these exact words, but this is the posture of a heart that's ready to make things right with God. If you'll confess Jesus with your mouth, again, and you'll ask Him today to be the leader and Lord of your life, I promise you that all of your yesterdays can be forgiven, and today you can have a right relationship with God. If that's you today, just pray with me. Pray something like this. Say, Jesus, I need you in my life today. I know that I'm broken and lost without you. I'm not proud of the choices that I've made, and when I cared absolutely nothing about you, you cared absolutely everything about me. I see that because you gave your Son to die on the cross for me, for my sin. And so today, I'm opening my heart to that truth. I know I won't do everything right, but I'm asking you today to come into my heart, be the leader and the Lord of my life from this day forward. In Jesus' name, I pray. Come on. And everybody said, amen. Amen. I love it, gang. I love it. I love it. Come on. I don't know about you, but I'm so fired up about what God is doing in all of our lives through this series and excited about the days ahead as we head towards Christmas. Come on. If you prayed that prayer today, if you made a decision to open your heart to Jesus, do me a favor. Text the words, turn my feet to 94000 right now, just like you see it below. Text, turn my feet. All one phrase, no capital letters, turn my feet to 94000 right now. I'd love to know that you made that decision so I could be praying for you, but also to help you with some next steps in the days ahead. Well, I hope you all have an amazing week. I'm excited beyond all imagination about what God is going to continue to do in our lives as we seek to serve genuine love at our table in the days ahead. Until next time, next week, we'll see you back here, same place. But remember this, God loves you. He's with you. He wants good things for your life. So come on, let's go after the good things of God together. Have an amazing day, everybody. God bless.